There are many kinds of compositions, that compositional forms that we have in Carnatic music. I'm actually going to brass tacks of forms right now, okay? You call Savar Geetam, you call Swarjiti, you say Tillana, you say Varnam, you say Kirtana, you say Kriti. So there are many. But whatever forms we have today are but manifestations of a basic tree structure, which is basically all compositional forms, everyone. Okay? All these words, you know. Every compositional form existent in Carnatic music today have some manifestations of these elements. There is no form that does not have. There could be some elements added, some deleted, all that could be there. But these, or parts of these, are always there. So I'm just going to go through some of the composition forms, and I may refer to history a little bit over here, because we need to know why it has a certain form. Now, I'll start with what we learn when we learn music, Geetam, what we call Geetam. See, the Geetam actually has a pre-Pallavi Anupallavi Chakra history. It is part of a musical tradition called the Chaturdandi tradition. The Chaturdandi was called, the four dandis were Alapa, Thaya, Prabandha and Geeta. Now I am not going to go into what that tradition was, because that is a word. But you can see that the word Geeta can mean many things. Geeta can mean just melodic line, it could mean a poetry, it could mean a form. It could mean so many things, but here we are specifically referring to a musical form when we sing. What makes the Geeta very interesting is the way you sing it. Everybody has heard Sri Ganganatha. Everybody, right? Yeah. Now, usually in all other forms that we have in Carnatic music, the refrain is sung first. Is sung first. Or for example, the Pallavi, if you want to call it the Pallavi, is sung first. Okay? In Geeta, that does not happen. This is very indicative. Shri Gananata Sindhura Varnaka Unasadana Kavi Vadana Lambodarana. So you are actually placing one, what we refer to as Charana. Then you are bringing in the Pallavi. Right? This is interesting by itself. The reason I say it, if any of you have read Jayadeva, Jayadeva's refrain always comes later. Vadasi yati kinchidapi dantaruchikamudi haratu dadati miramati godam spuradadarashidara tavavadana chandrama rochayatulo chanachako. Charushile is actually the refrain. Right? This is a remaining of an older musical tradition, which is part of Chaturdandi, in which the form called Prabandha was the primary form. This has got nothing to do with Divya Prabandha, before anybody asks me that question. Nothing to do with the Divya Prabandha. Okay? The Prabandha had its non-removal part, which is essential for the Prabandha, as a center point in the compositional form. The Dhruvam was called the most important part of the Prabandha. And it was not presented first. It was presented in the middle. So the Geeta somewhere is a link to the Prabandha tradition. That is why all the Geeta, though we call it Pallavi and Charana today, the refrain only comes later. Okay? So this has a unique status in compositional forms today. Definitely.
I don't understand.
You don't need to appreciate it. But every musical form has one line that is reiterated. I call it the refrain. Now, I love you very much. because those, so you're a lovely, beautiful girl, I think you have, whatever, blah, 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 I love you very much. Now that's the refrain. Usually, the refrain is the first element. You state it. And then, you start adding descriptive, metaphorical, substantiative elements.
Lyrical meaning or lyrical meaning?
I'm talking about lyrical meaning here. Specifically, lyrical form. And melodically also what happens is that melodic line is being surveyed. Both ways, you know. I gave you the lyrical meaning so you understand what the refrain is. Basically for P.H. Arushile. So P.H. Arushile, that's exactly why I said it. But, so usually what happens in compositions that we render today, the melodic form that is repeated or that is refrained is usually the first part. And then you build and then you come back and you reiterate, even melodically, just as a melodic creation. In the Gita, it's very interesting that you actually sing one piece of melody and then you come to the point of melodic. And then you sing another piece of melody, then you come back and it here. Now, which is unusual compared to that. So, I'm saying the reason for that is because it resembles to a certain extent an older musical form. And that musical form, Prabandha, seems to have had some connection with Jayadeva, who goes back, I don't know, 12th century, I think, am I wrong, right? I don't know. 12th century Jayadeva? 12th or 13th, maybe, I don't know. So, it goes back to some poetic forms that was there. Now, I come to, before I go to another form of composition, I say one very interesting thing. Can anybody for me recite any Sanskrit poetry, anything? I'm very bad at it, that's why I'm asking you. Any poetry that has about four lines, 8 lines, two lines, doesn't matter. Anybody? I don't remember anything. Anybody can help me or we get lost? Okay, now if I was going to tune this, put this in music. Now, before I come to you, I've used this word Abhupalini here. Okay? Now, the biggest challenge has been is how do I differentiate between a Pallavi and Anupalli. Now, that's a very interesting problem. Now, if I had his shlokam, for example, I can tune the first two lines as the Pallavi and have the second two lines as the Anupallavi and refrain the first two lines. Nothing stops me from doing it. Or, I can put all the four lines as the Pallavi. Understood? Anybody lost here, please stop me. Pallavi is the beginning point. Here I'm taking Pallavi, start of a composition. The four lines that he gave me can be rendered as a composite Pallavi, or I can say the first two lines in the Pallavi, the next two lines will be Anupallavi.
So I can refrain whichever part from the beginning over and over.
The first two lines are complete by themselves. They can be refrained.
They can.
I think linguistic meaning. They can. There's no problem. This problem is a very interesting problem. Sanskrit poetry has never used this idea. It came from Tamil poetry. Okay. So what they said is, how do I identify an Anupallavi? This was a challenge that many people, we have in this Purandara Dasa also. Now for example, Purandara Dasa, all his songs could be in four line couplets. Now I can take first four lines as Pallavi, as the whole refrain, or I can split that and still go back. Now which was the Pallavi, which was the Anupallavi is something nobody seemed to have worked out. So then you come to a poetic point. There's something called Dviti Akshara Prasa. This is the second syllable of the Pallavi line will always match the second syllable of the Anupallavi line. I'll give you an example. Pallavi first line, Anupallavi line. Ka will not match, but it does.
Ka-ma-la-ma-ma.
If the second syllable matched, it becomes the Anupallavi. It's first called the Dviti Akshara Prasa, okay? There is also Prathama Akshara Prasa, Antim Akshara Prasa. Prathama Akshara is the first Akshara, Dviti Akshara second, Antim Akshara last. But I am leaving this Prathama and Antim out. You can have those prasas also, that's the poetry, that's the composer's prerogative. But in the Anuppallavi, if you had an Anuppallavi for any kind of composition other than Gita, and that's why I'm coming generic now and then going to them, because all of the compositions follow this principle. And this comes from Mone Yodhiye and Tamil Asurva. It's all from Tamil. If you take Jayadeva's poetry, you don't find Dvitiyakshara Prasa at all. He's not used this concept. It's a purely Tamil concept that flowed into Telugu, Kannada and Sanskrit poetry in the South. Dvitiyakshara Prasa, Dvitiyakshara Prasa. You take any Tyagaraja Kirtana, take the second syllable of the Pallavi line, it will be the same as the second syllable of the Anuppallavi. The Charana will be independent. The Charana Prasa will be independent of Pallavi. It need not match the Pallavi. So the only way actually from just a set of lyrics given to me, I can actually identify if it is written by, say, a composer, Vagyakara like Annamacharya or somebody. I can look at it and figure out the Anuppallavi only by this pattern, because I don't have the melody, right? I have the lyrics. But by the Akshara, I can tell you which is the Pallavi and which is the Anuppallavi.
But you still have the problem of breaking it up.
I won't have the problem. The moment I know the third line, first second syllable matches the first line, second syllable, I know the third line is Anuppallavi. And then you will find that the next four lines will be of a complete different prasa. Independent of these two. In case of just pure poetry, which did not have to have melody, then this you don't have to worry about it. Sometimes you have all four lines following the same process. All you have all that happening. But that's different. I'm talking only musically contextual poetry. Question somebody?
I wouldn't ask about all the lines at the
same. Yeah, you could have that. But in any poetry, if you take any compass, for example, Kamala Amma Majare. Kamalambam Bajare Re Manasa, Kamalamani Pantuli, Sarvashatpari has no connection.
Sarvashatpari Puraka Chakra Swamini Paramashiva Kamini Durva.
Anybody notice the prasa here? Sarva, Urva, but that's completely independent of Kamala, Kamala, Ma in the Kamala Ma Bajari or Ma in the. Another example?
Mithitsayala Sukhama Ramni Sannidhi Seva Sukhama Nijamudabal Dadhina Vanita Kshira Murucho. It's
completely different.
Dhamashama Manoganga Snanamu Sukama Kardama
Dhamma
Kardama Durvishaya Sukuta Snanamu Sukama Mamata,
you can see it's completely different. Mamata, Dhamma Sharma, Mamata. That's a different prasa completely. So Charana prasa is independent, but Charana also has a prasa. You can have Antim Aksharas also meeting. That's the last Akshara. You can have the Prathama Aksharas also meeting. But for something to be identified as Anuppallavi, it needs to have Dviti Akshara prasa. Dviti Akshara prasa is very crucial for this Anuppallavi status. The Anuppallavi is usually. Now, I have mentioned this in general because you find this tendency in most of the musical forms I want to discuss now. This Dvitiyakshara matches almost every musical form. Every musical form seems to have used it. I first thought it was only the Kirtana and Kriti, even I thought. Then when I started looking at other compositional forms, I find that even they have matched it. They have used it all over. And it's something that has come out of, very important it seems, all scholars agree that it came from Tamil. This whole idea of doing this came from Tamil. And not from, because not of Sanskrit poetry from out or northern side of India do not use the diction. So whether it was contextual to music that this idea came, I don't know. I'm not aware of it. So, they say even Sangam literature, they have this. It's already this kind of process. Now, Gita, then you have something called the Varna. Varna. Everybody knows, has heard the word. Everybody has heard the Varna. Who has not heard? Have you all heard the word Varna?
No,
okay. Not. Good. The Varna is considered one of the most important compositional forms to be learned as a student of music. And in concert music, it's usually presented at the beginning of a concert. Why it is presented is a... but it is usually present at the beginning of a concert. Now, the musical form of Varna is quite a spectacular form. The Varna has usually two lines, that is the Pallavi. Okay? Then it has about two lines, that is two or four, sometimes also four. Okay? When I say four lines here, one round of that tala, which is called an avartana, which I didn't choose all this while, is what I mean by saying, when I say two lines, I mean two avartanas. When I say four lines, I mean four avartanas. Okay? So usually this will be two avartanas, this will be two to four. Then what will happen here is some modifications to this plan. There will be something, a passage of say about four avartanas, all these are approximate, about four, called Mukta Isra, which is purely swaras with no lyrics, rather linguistic lyrics or even non-linguistic meaning sung, just swaras being sung, which will lead back to this. Okay?
Avartam is a repetition.
Avartam is, if it's Aditana, if you put eight counts, the completion of the first eight is one avartam. Then you go back to one, second avartam. The cyclical form that we discussed, the structure of cyclical form is that. So you have Pallavi, Anupallavi, then this Mukta Iswara, and then you go back to Pallavi. This ends the first part of the Varna. After this concludes, you have one statement that comes as a chara. I'll just sing and show you also. That comes as a chara. It is usually one avartana. One avartana, usually. Attached to this, you have multiple swaras. Usually a minimum of, so when I say minimum of 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 7, each swara, when rendered, will have to again go back here. Swaram 2 will be rendered, again go back here. So for the second part of this composition, the charanam becomes the melodic refrain. The Pallavi loses its importance in this part. In the first part of the Varnam, the Pallavi is the refrain. So the charanam becomes a refrain. Then you sing two swarams. All these are composed. All these are as composed. Or four swarams and conclude here. Now this is how we listen to Varnam. I just quickly sing you this part of it.
These swarams are called what they are also called?
Some people call it Chitta Swaram, but the older term is Yathigada Swaram. Yathigada Swaram is the older term that is used. Now, if I sing a Varnam, I will sing a Saveri Dharam, Adi Kala, Rente Kala. I think all this is understood now, right? That's why I am using all these terms.
Sarasudaya Ninne Kori Shri Venkatesha.
What do you hear? Okay, after this you hear all the swarams. Even in that we have forgotten one swaram which is there. You don't sing it. That apart. Then goes on. Chiru nau mo. Obviously, musicians' practice is quite a waste of time. But anyway,
I wish it was the audience.